Previously, it was possible to edit music in Melodyne on the melodic and harmonic levels, but not on the level of sound, as we are used to doing with synthesizers, for example, or effects devices. We wouldn't normally expect to be able to work with recorded audio in the same way as with a synthesizer. They are two different worlds. But since Melodyne knows so much already about the sound from its analysis, it would be a shame not to make full use of this knowledge. Moreover, Melodyne knows not only the overall sound, but also, thanks to its polyphonic analysis, the sound of each individual note. And it is of this that the essential work of the sound editor consists, the editing of individual notes, including those extracted from polyphonic material, and the editing of their respective overtones, these together constituting the sound. I have here a tambura sound, a suitable illustration because the tambura, an Indian instrument, has a very even basic sound with a great many overtones, the amplitude of which is almost uniform. If you listen to the sound and also look down here at the amplitude of the individual tones, you'll notice that the individual overtones, around 120 of them are displayed here, are all relatively loud. Think of it this way. The sound has been reduced to its overtones, and you can make each individual overtone as loud or as quiet as you like, thereby controlling the timbre. Let's take an extreme illustration. Here I remove all the partials, and then, as with the drawbars of an organ, only with a far more extensive array, I raise the amplitude of individual overtones. For example, the seventh overtone only of this sound, or the fifth. Let's take a rather weird one, the 11th. And then, further along, a hump made up of many overtones. And then once more, the total sound. Already, I think you have a pretty good idea of how the sound is being taken to pieces and then reassembled. It has to be pointed out that we aren't dealing here with additive resynthesis, because with resynthesis, a sound is always composed of sine tones, whereas in a natural sound, there are always other tones in between. If you were to generate the sound via resynthesis from sine tones, part of the natural sound would be lost. The bands here, these overtones that I am raising, govern the range within which each overtone is found, and not just a single sine tone representing this frequency. In this way, it is always the entire original sound that is being edited, so the sound always remains natural. Since the spectrum of a sound is composed of overtones, you can readily see that it is possible to assign the tonal characteristics of one sound to another. Which is not to say that you can turn one instrument into a completely different one, as what is happening in a sound does not depend solely upon the overtone spectrum. But the basic sound can definitely be transferred. A clarinet provides a useful illustration, as its sound is composed almost entirely of odd-numbered overtones.
Ich hole hier mal ins Bild ein Stück Klarinette und lasse das mal laufen.
You can see here that the second overtone is relatively quiet, as is the fourth. And bear in mind that this is a logarithmic display. In reality, with a linear display, the differences would be even more pronounced. But already you can see clearly that the overtones alternate. Further up, they do so to a lesser extent.
Und wenn ich hier jetzt aber sage, ich will dieses Spektrum kopieren,
now, if I take a saxophone, and transfer the spectrum of the clarinet to the saxophone, it sounds like this. This means the overtone structure of the saxophone has been overlaid with that of the clarinet. And using these sliders, their macro controls to save you dragging every single overtone fader by hand, you can emphasize or attenuate characteristics. If I want to lean more heavily towards the clarinet, then I simply magnify here these differences.
Und dann klingt das auch noch mehr in Richtung Klarinette.
Or I can invert the differences by moving the slider into the negative domain.
Dann werden die Unterschiede umgekehrt sozusagen. Das heißt, als Bild könnte man.
You could say then, the saxophone now sounds even more saxophone-like from the clarinet's perspective.
Kann man also diese Unterschiede in beide Richtungen verstärken oder.
In this way, you can emphasize, attenuate, or invert the differences in both directions.
Unterschiede verstärken.
Differences in general are a very important subject. I'm fascinated by questions like, what does each sound consist of? What is peculiar about it? And how can I emphasize the extent to which it departs from a given mean? From what one might call a gray sound, or from white noise, or from a sonic mean derived from the source material. And that is exactly what we see here. This spectrum has been extracted from all the tones found in the original recording. Starting from it, you make relative changes, raising or lowering the level of individual tones, or all tones simultaneously. This does not have to remain static, though.
Da haben wir hier zwei Regler, die die Unterschiede nicht statisch im Spektrum.
We have here two sliders that govern the differences dynamically, in the sense of the momentarily heard sound.
Also jeder Klang in jeder.
So with each sound evaluated, we ask virtually every millisecond, what is this sound like? What are its peculiar characteristics? Where does it differ from the mean sound of the recording as a whole? This is very well illustrated by a wah-wah guitar, because there are pronounced differences in the sound that we can further emphasize by making the sound more characteristic, so to speak, in each area.
Der Klang wird sozusagen in sich charakteristischer an jeder Stelle.
Let's listen. Here I turn it up. And further still, entering the effects domain. The opposite is also very nice when I make it grayer, so to speak. That is to say, gradually deprive it of its character, so that there is almost nothing more of the wah-wah pedal to be heard, because all the tones sound similar. I'll just go back. Now the sound is totally neutral. All the tones are the same, so to speak. Now let's return to the original. The slider next to it does something similar with respect to the dynamics. Before it was the comparison with the mean timbre. Now it's the comparison with the mean amplitude within the individual notes. As I turn it up, the loud pieces become louder and the quiet places even quieter. Or the reverse, until practically everything is uniformly loud. You can hear this, too, very well. As I turn it up, the differences are emphasized. Now the attacks are very short and vanish instantly. Or in the opposite direction. Now the notes are practically always equally loud. Now I move both sliders at the same time. Now we've got not only a uniform sound, but also a level envelope. When you want to change a sound through its overtones, you can do this either by resizing individual overtone beams, thereby boosting specific overtones in a targeted way, or by using macro functions to edit the spectrum. The simplest, naturally, is the balance. I'll turn it up a bit. It's similar to a tone control, more treble, more bass. However, this Brilliance macro is in one respect fundamentally different from a normal tone control, and that it governs each note individually. For this reason, it is primarily the overtones of the lower notes that are boosted, while the effect on the higher notes is less pronounced because, in their case, the very high overtones are no longer audible. So it changes the character of the instrument, the physics of the instrument, one might say. Also interesting is the possibility of magnifying the differences in the spectrum that are already present, or else reducing them. Here I have heightened the character. Or I might make the spectrum more neutral. Perhaps together with the Brilliance control. So that all the overtones are equally loud, which leads in this case to a relatively bright sound. To alter a sound globally, you can also boost or attenuate the odd or even-numbered overtones. Attenuating the even-number ones results in a comparatively hollow sound, similar to that of a clarinet. If, on the other hand, the odd-numbered overtones disappear, all that remain are the octaves of the second overtone, and everything sounds as though an octave higher. First, let's take the odd ones. The piano now assumes a hollower sound. Or if I now fade in the even ones, everything sounds as though an octave higher. The notes themselves, though, have not gone up an octave. It's just that only their octave component is audible. If you thin out the spectrum still further, removing successively different overtones until only every fifth, sixth, or seventh is left sounding, you get a Glockenspiel-like character, as large holes appear in the spectrum.
ganz andere Darstellung als der Eingriff in die Harmonik.
For a different view of the sound, there's the display of the entire spectrum.
Also hier haben wir ja die Obertöne jedes einzelnen Tons, und wenn ich auf diesen
When I switch to EQ mode, it all has pretty much the accustomed aspect of a normal equalizer. Not as before, a reference to the individual fundamental and its overtones, but the display of the entire spectrum, regardless of which note it now is. But here too, I can use the macros. I'll just let a bit of guitar run. I can simply raise the highs, for example, or neutralize the spectrum. Editing the individual semitones also has exciting possibilities. A normal equalizer generally has bands a third wide or thereabouts. This equalizer, in contrast, is divided up in such a way that the individual bands correspond exactly to individual semitones. The semitones, in this case, adopt the tuning determined by Melodyne.
In dem Fall aber eben nicht die Noten sozusagen, sondern wenn ich ein C anhebe, werden...
So what you are boosting or attenuating are the actual tones found in the piece. In this case, however, not the notes exactly, because if I edit a C, the amplitude of all the C partials of all the notes is raised or lowered. You can obtain really beautiful effects with this. If you leave all the tones that belong to the key standing and remove all the others, very unusual sound effects result, because this is not something you can normally do. Or the opposite. I can remove the tones that belong to the tonality. By this means, I can get very weird, almost noise-like sounds. In this way, you can radically alter sounds or create totally new ones, particularly in conjunction with the other settings, that is to say, by emphasizing differences, making changes to the spectrum, or emphasizing notes belonging to the key. Forman editing has been possible with Melodyne from its inception, being used primarily, of course, to ensure that when individual notes were transposed, they retained their sound character, and that chipmunk effect were avoided.
Zu diesen Mickey Mouse Effekten kommt, sondern dass der Ton wie original so gesungen klingt, und das hat man eben.
This was achieved by shifting the entire Forman spectrum. There could be no talk of individual Formans.
Die gesamte Formantlage verschoben wird.
And this is precisely what is new here, as now you are no longer confined to shifting the entire Forman spectrum, but can access individual formant regions. From these four-part vocals, I take the bass,
und hier ist auch in der Spektrumsansicht, in dieser EQ-Ansicht.
In the EQ view, it is now clearly apparent that in this area here, there is a large hump.
Richtiger großer Buckel ist, und das ist jetzt tatsächlich.
That is in fact a formant. Normally, it would be like this.
Der Sänger singt ja verschiedene.
He sings the words Madonna mia cara, a phrase containing very different vowel sounds. You'd think then that the formants would scatter to very different frequencies and average themselves out over the entire EQ spectrum. But there is such a thing as a singer's formant. Every trained male singer has a characteristic formant. This manifests itself in an accumulation of energy at a particular point in the spectrum. Now I can hear and see displayed the location of the singer's formant, select it, and even move it, without altering the entire formant spectrum, but simply the one area that is characteristic of the singer.
Hören wir uns das mal an.
Madonna mia cara, mi follere tanzan.
Zusätzlich dazu, dass man den...
Instead of simply editing the natural sound, I can also morph continuously into resynthesis.
Also normalerweise ist ja so, wenn ich jetzt diese Obertonbalken verändere,
when I was resizing the overtone beams just now, nothing was synthesized. It was simply a case of emphasizing or toning down individual aspects of the natural sound by changing the beam settings. But I can actually also create a synthesizer-like sound through the resynthesis of the amplitudes and phases.
Herstellen. Beispielsweise, ich lasse das mal laufen.
At the moment, the sounds are still relatively vibrant. The balls are dancing.
Ich sehe hier aber nur ein bestimmtes Spektrum. Und wenn ich jetzt die Resynthese aufdrehe...
But if I turn up the resynthesis, these bouncing balls more or less come to rest on the spectrum. That means you hear now practically nothing but the spectrum, as you see here. In the static sound, the phases play no role, but with the attacks, the phasing ensures that there is a real click, an attack.
Macht die Phasenlage eigentlich aus, dass es wirklich ein Klack, ein Anschlag ist.
And if I also resynthesize the phases, the attacks seem more artificial, and the whole thing sounds more like a synthesizer. If I now further modify the spectrum by introducing a hump here, or adopting a completely random spectrum, and alter the envelopes, or particular formants, it can readily be seen that you can also use the Melodyne sound editor as a synthesizer, and that by combining these functions, you can do all sorts of things.